So last time I gave you a little teaser about these categories that are built on top of other categories and so on. So I want to continue today and maybe establish a little bit more facts about what I was talking last time. So we started with a category. And then we said, okay, between categories, we can establish these functors, okay? And what happened is in the process that we realized that these functors actually, they can be composed, right? So in Haskell, you can compose functors. There is a data type. I don't know if it's called data or it's new type, probably new type. New type. Compose, I think, and it takes two functors, f and g, and some type a, right? And it's defined, its constructor is compose takes f, well, I don't know which order it's composed, but probably this order, right? Or maybe the other order. So composing two functors, f and g, when they act on some type A, because functors are type constructors, right? So if, when they act on some type A, we just act with one functor, and then on the result, we act with another functor. So it's like a composition of functions, but it's acting on types, right, type constructors. And it's easy to prove that, that if f and g are functors, so they have F maps, then you can compose the F maps as well. So you get a composition of F maps. So compose actually creates a new functor that's a composition of the other functors, right? So we have functors. And in general, almost these are endofunctors in Haskell. But in general, these are functors between categories. So if you think, you know, here we have a category C, right? Functor f going to some other category d, right? And we can have some other category e and another functor g, okay? So this is what it looks like, right? But of course, there can be many functors here, and many functors here, right? Lots of functors possible between categories. So if functors compose and there is an identity functor, it's also in Haskell we can define it as, you know, new type, identity on some type A is just equal ID A. So it just takes a type A and just puts it in. Doesn't do anything with it. So it's like if you think of functors and the functors as containers, it's a container that just contains one thing. Right? And if you use compose with this identity, then you get back whatever functor. So it forms a category, right? And this category in which functors are morphisms, objects are categories, is called the category of categories. It's the cat category, right? And modulo problems with size, you know, it's like category of all categories is not a category of, and so on, right? So when you can work with small categories and then it actually creates a category, which is not small. So, but then I said, okay, but we can have a category in which functors themselves are objects. And then if you have a functor F, then you can go to another functor G, and that's called a natural transformation, right? So natural transformations map functors to functors, okay? And these natural transformations, they are families of morphisms. Right? So for every object in F, there is a morphism in G. And it's called a component alpha A. So if you have an object A here, then it is mapped into a morphism called alpha sub A, which is just a particular morphism. It's called a component of this natural transformation. And because components of natural transformations are just morphisms, you know, then if you have another one that's so this is alpha, this is beta, that takes, you know, A into beta A. Since these are morphisms, well, we can compose them, right? So and there is an identity natural transformation you can figure out easily. It's just all its components are identities on objects. So functors between two categories also form a category in which morphisms are natural transformations. So now if we go back to this picture, okay, where is this category sitting? Huh. It's interesting because these guys are functors, right? So this is like a functor. Well, I use capital letters, so let's use capital letter. So this is F and G. A natural transformation maps functors. So it is often written as an arrow between functors. So this is my alpha. Okay? So now we are getting an interesting structure. Right? And there are some other functors, F prime, G prime, and there's some, you know, alpha prime, and so on. So we are getting a richer structure. We have a category in which we have objects, right, which are categories in this case. We have morphisms, which are functors, right? And then within this, what we could call a home set between two categories, right? The home set is a set of functors, but it's not just a set. It's actually a category. So we get instead of a home set, we have a home category. Okay? So that's like a next level of abstraction where we have and there is a new language to call these things, like because these look like cells. So people call objects, they rename them as zero cells. Morphisms between these objects are called one cells. And morphisms between morphisms are called two cells. So alpha is a two cell. Okay? And this is a particular example. This is a category of categories, and we have functors and natural transformations. But this structure can be abstracted. We can say, what if we have a category in which not only we have zero cells and one cell, but we also have two cells between one cell? Okay, so that's getting interesting. A category like this, which has zero cells, one cells, and two cells, it's called a two category. And you might say, okay, can we go further with this? Say, okay, we have one natural transformation alpha here, and another one called beta. What if we had like another morphism between, right? I mean, why not? We can have, so this would be zero cell, this would be one cell, this is a two cell, this is a three cell, okay? So if we have something like this, well, we would call it like a three category, right? And we can continue with this, and we can say, well, we can have an N category. And there's this website, N categories, right? This is because this is like a very interesting topic of research. Why is this a topic of research? This is because this is very non-trivial, okay? I'm just sketching touching the surface of this. Because when you are defining a two category, then you have to think about so-called coherence conditions, right? Like these, now you have more structure. You have one cells and you have two cells. How do one cells interact with two cells, right? So for instance, in a two category, there is a special condition that tells you that if you compose two cells in this direction vertically, and you can also compose them horizontally, then the order in which you do this doesn't matter, right? So there's some complicated diagrams that have to commute and so on. So there are all these complicated conditions. And if you go higher to n categories, not only you get more of these additional conditions, right? These coherence conditions, but you also, they are not obvious. So some people might pick one condition and other people might pick another one and nobody knows which one is better, right? So this is like a huge topic of research, just figuring out the coherence conditions. So that people haven't figured out the n-category theory yet. However, there is one simpler case in which they pretty much figured things out, and that's a generalization in which we replace a category with a thing called groupoid. Groupoid is a category in which every morphism automatically has an inverse. Like, remember the isomorphisms? So a category in which all morphisms are isomorphisms is called a groupoid. So this is sort of like a category in which you don't have arrows, you just have lines, right? You have edges, because every pair of arrows that are invertible, you know, is just, you can replace it with one line. So this is called a groupoid. And now with groupoids, you can do the same thing. You can say, what if I have n groupoids, right? So you have all these things suddenly become invertible. So they are isomorphisms, and these become isomorphisms, and this becomes isomorphism, and so on. And coherence conditions for these isomorphisms are easier, okay? And then people notice that if you have this kind of structure, well, so one thing is that there is a good model for this that mathematicians have, and that's called homotopy. And in homotopy, you have situations like this where you have two points in a space, right? And you have paths, right? So you can go from one point A to another point B. And usually, when you have paths, that you can either go one way or you can come back, right, on the same path. So all these paths are invertible. You can go and then come back, right? So these are sort of like isomorphisms, right? So if you look at paths as morphisms or isomorphisms, right? Then you can have like a homeset between two points, right? All possible paths there. And now you can ask yourself, you know, what I deform this path into this path, okay? So you can just like go and do a little movie. You know, this path is moving, and it becomes this path. Okay, that's a morphism also, but it's a two-cell now. So a two-cell, you can think of a two-cell as like filling the space between these two morphisms. Okay, and sometimes you have a two-cell, or sometimes you can't deform one into another. Like if you look into some topological spaces with interesting properties, what if there is a hole in between? Okay, you have a space and there's a hole. You have one path here, another path here, but you cannot deform this one because you hit the hole and it's not, okay? So there is a nice model in topology, this homotopy. And of course it goes infinitely far, because now you can have like two membranes here, and you can animate one of them going into another, right? And so on. And the interesting thing is, and this is where homotopy type theory comes in, is people realize that there is an analogous thing in the foundations of mathematics. Namely, people were trying to define what it means for two things to be equal. Okay? And if you model equality between two things as a path between them, right? Why would you want to model equality as a path? Because in a constructive type theory, every equality comes with a proof, okay? So saying just A equals B doesn't have much information, but saying I have a proof that A equals B, okay? That's constructive. But now if you have a proof that A is equal B, what if you have another proof that A is equal B, right? Are these two proofs equal? I mean, if you treat proofs of equality as elements that you can manipulate, then you might ask questions like, are these two proofs equal? But then equality of two proofs is just like a, you know, a morphism between them. If they are equal or not. Are they equal? Well, maybe they are, maybe they're not. So is there a path from one path to another path, and so on. And this also goes to infinity, because you can have equality of equality of equality, and so on. And each of them requires a proof, okay? So this is what homotopy type theory is about. They didn't want to have equality as something that is either true or false, right? The standard traditional mathematics is either these things are equal or not. And now we are asking a question, well, what's the proof? You cannot say they are equal or not unless you have a proof. And this proof becomes an object or a path here, right? And then you can have this whole hierarchy of proofs and of proofs of proofs of proofs, right? And that's what homotopy type theory is about. Okay, so that's a teaser. Okay, very abstract. Like if somebody is interested in homotopy type theory, this is where homotopy type theory comes in, right? And it's related to type theory because we'll be talking about type theory a little bit today, using these constructions like product, co-product, and so on, And one of these constructions when you go into homotopy type theory is equality. Equality is a type, okay? And a member of equality is a proof of this type, okay? So, but I will not do that. That would require a completely separate set of lectures. There are actually very good lectures on YouTube. Okay, so now let's go get into technical. Well, before we got into technical details, let me give you some intuition about what I'm trying to do. Okay, so I said before that in category theory, we are not supposed to look inside of objects, right? So there are these two worldviews. Let me draw an object as this blob here, right? There's one view where we look, we study the object by looking inside of it. So we look at, let's say, if this is a set, we look at the elements of set. And we define all kinds of types of objects by saying, how many elements they have, right? So that's the internal view, looking at elements. Category theory looks at arrows. So we forget about stuff that's inside. We are looking at what are the arrows that either go into this object or come out of this object. And all the properties of the object So there is this duality. All properties of this object can be either described using elements, or we can have this alternate view. All properties of this object can be defined using arrows. Okay? And there is this duality. You can look at the arrows that are incoming into an object. If you talk about the object by specifying what arrows go into an object, you are, from the point of view of programmers, we are talking about constructors, right? This object here is some type. And arrows that go into it are functions that return this type. So these are the constructors. They take some arguments, right? Other objects around it, right? And they produce this object. Okay, so incoming arrows describe the construction. And in type theory, this is called introduction rules. So you specify what an object is by specifying the introduction rules. But then you can also specify the arrows that are coming out of this object. That's, for programmers, that's functions that work on objects. So these are functions that take this object as an input, right? So they sort of, well, maybe not destructors, that's maybe not a good thing, but these are just functions that operate on the object, right? So these are, in type theory, these are called elimination rules. So these are introduction rules, and these are elimination rules, okay? They don't really eliminate the object, because the object might still survive this. Although in some, like in linear type theories, the object does not survive the elimination, right? The linear types, that's an interesting topic in Haskell. So we have introduction and elimination rules. So we start constructing, making these constructions using introduction and elimination rules. But what's the relationship between these two? Well, if you have a good set of introduction and elimination rules, then they should sort of be the inverse of each other, right? If you eliminate an object that's been introduced, right, then it sort of get you an identity, right? And vice versa, if you eliminate something and then construct, then it should like leave the world the same, right? So good pairs of introduction and elimination rules have to cancel each other. And that leads to another set of rules that contribute to this picture. And these are the, we programmers call it beta elimination and eta elimination rules. These are just like intro after elim and elim after intro, okay? So we'll be concentrating on these four rules. And in type theory, these rules are introduced as axioms, okay? And you just have to take them on faith. But I want to introduce these things through category theory. And I think category theory provides a nicer language because you can draw pictures, right? And these rules become much easier when you actually look at pictures. Okay, so let's get to the first construction. Okay, the first construction. Oh, and every time I introduce a construction, I will look at it from all possible points of view. So we'll start with category theory, right? I'll show you what it is in a category theory. But then I'll give you an interpretation as logic and an interpretation in type theory, in logic, and even in lambda calculus. Okay? So this should be interesting. So the first construction is called a terminal object. Terminal object is also known in logic as truth, or the value of true. Okay. In set theory, a set theory is a model for category theory, for type theory. It's a this kind of simplified model. It's a singleton set. And for us programmers, this is called unit type in type theory, but also in Haskell, called unit type. Unit type is this type, right? An empty tuple. So let's start with category theory. In category theory, the terminal object is defined as an object that has a morphism from every object in the category. So a terminal object, you know, is T, whatever object you pick, A, you know, there is a morphism going from A to T. Okay? Moreover, and this is like all these constructions in category theory have this property. First of all, they involve every object in the category, right? Because since you cannot look inside T, right, the other option is you have to look at the rest of the category. And really, you have to look at every other object in the category. If you just miss one object, then this construction doesn't work, okay? So every object, which also includes the object itself that you are defining. Okay? So if I'm saying that there is a morphism from every object to terminal object, there's also a morphism from terminal object to itself. Now, that would not be a big surprise, because we know that there is an ID always there, right? But there is the second part of this. This is called a universal construction. These kind of constructions are called universal constructions. So one part of the universal construction is the existence of something, and the other is uniqueness. Okay? So there is a unique morphism from any object to the terminal object. There are no two morphisms. There has to be one. Okay? Therefore, you know, identity has to be the only looping or terminal object. Okay. So let's like if we try to pick a type in Haskell, that would mean there is a type that has this function from A to this type, we don't know what, right? For any A, there is a function like this. And it has to be unique. So there cannot be two. So like if we tried, let's say bool, okay? Maybe bool is a terminal object. Well, there is a function from every type to bool. That's true, right? There is a function true. True that takes whatever x and returns true. Okay? But it's not unique. There's another one called false. So Boolean is not a terminal object, right? So what could be a terminal object? Well, if we want to have a uniqueness here, then it has to have a single element, right? So this is why the terminal object in Haskell is the unit type. And this function from A to unit, what's it called? Unit. Yeah. So you can look it up in the library. There is a function called unit. It takes A. It ignores its argument, obviously, but it returns a single element of unit type, which is also called empty tuple. And it's of the type unit. Okay? So that's the cuteness of Haskell. Okay, so wait. That's the next thing I want to say. Yes. So It is unique. So the question is this a unique thing, right? If it exists. It doesn't have to exist, not in every category. It exists in this category of types, right? But in general, it doesn't have to exist. You can think of categories that don't have a terminal object. If you take a category like this, right? There's no terminal object.
Well,
it does, okay. But this one does, right? With two objects and two morphisms. It doesn't have a terminal object. There's no uniqueness. So is it unique? So with every construction, universal construction, the answer is if it exists, it exists. It's unique up to an isomorphism, and in fact, it's unique up to a unique isomorphism. So there's only one isomorphism, and this is very easy to prove. And maybe I should show you the proof because it's diagrammatic, and it's very categorical. So this is how people prove things in category theory. So how do you prove that there is a unique terminal object? Well, let's assume that it's not unique and there are two of these. Okay, so let's suppose that there is T1 and T2. Okay, and now we just use the definition of the terminal object. Okay, so if T1 is a terminal object, it means there is a unique morphism from T2 to T1, right? So there has to be some F from T2 to T1. But T2 is also a terminal object, so there has to be a unique morphism that's called a G, right? Okay. So what's the... What if we apply one after another, right? Compose these two. So let's say G after F. G after F. So we go from, first we go this way and this way. We end up here. So we haven't moved. So the combination of these two has to be a loopy thingy, right? So if F is from T1 to T2, then G after F is from T2 to T2, back to T2. So G after F is from T2 to T2. But T2 is a terminal object, so it has a unique morphism from itself to itself. But we know that there is one already because there has to be an ID, right? So this unique morphism has to be ID. It cannot be two, right? So G after F must be equal to ID at T2. Now what about F after G? F after G, G first, F, it's an identity in T1, right? So these two are inverse of each other, meaning it's an isomorphism. This is the definition of isomorphism, right? This is, by definition, an isomorphism. And not only that, it's a unique isomorphism because F and G are unique, because we started with a terminal condition, right? So every universal construction that's done this way will end up as being unique up to unique isomorphism, right? And that's good enough. This is like the best thing that we can get in category theory, uniqueness up to unique isomorphism. The equality is not really defined for objects, so this is good enough, right? Okay, so let's interpret this in type theory, okay? In type theory, you talk about introduction rules and elimination rules. So this guy has an introduction rule because you can always create it from anything else. So this is how do we write it in type theory? We say if in any context gamma, right, there is, and this is what they, okay, so now I have to like switch between different notations. I don't know, should we keep the notation? Mathematical notation would be this, okay, that this is the terminal object or top, and this is its only element, right? So how is this thing, and this means that from no assumptions, this is empty about this this line, from no assumptions whatsoever, you can deduce that there is an element of type T, that type T has an inhabitant. There is an inhabitant, and it's called star. Okay, so which this corresponds to, you know, in Haskell, to this. As I said, there is one single inhabitant of this. Okay, so how is this thing interpreted? In lambda calculus. Okay, now let's switch to lambda calculus. So in lambda calculus, these things are interpreted as morphisms. So star. So when you look at something like this, okay, maybe I should start with interpretation of lambda calculus, okay? Interpretation of lambda calculus in category theory, okay? Objects are types. Now, we generalize it a little bit by saying objects can be types or contexts. So this kind of gamma thing. Later, it will become obvious that contexts are also types, because a context consists of a bunch of types, right? It's a product, in a categorical sense, a product of types. So these are all types. and there are morphisms. Morphisms are what we call terms. Terms are morphisms between types, okay? So if I'm going to read this as a in category theory, I will say there is a morphism called star that goes from gamma to T. Okay, that's the interpretation of these symbols from one theory in another theory. Okay, this is exactly the same thing, but they use different notation. Okay, so in type theory, they use this notation. In category theory, we would translate it to this. In Haskell, we would say, you know, no, we would say unit. Unit. Okay, see, this is called unit. This is a morphism called unit. Gamma is an arbitrary type. Terminal object is the unit type, okay? So there's like a dictionary. So I'm like teaching you several languages at the same time, right? This is English, this is Spanish, this is German, and so on. But they all correspond. There's like one-to-one correspondence, right? This is actually the same theory. So this is wonderful. Finally, in logic. Okay, in logic, this, and this is the kind of logic, you know, the good logic, the logic which actually is meaningful in terms of proofs, proof-relevant logic. It says, in any context, there is a proof of truth. Okay, the truth object exists, and it's always true. And here's the proof, okay? So this is the proof of some proposition, okay? This proposition is a very special proposition that says, I'm true, always, okay, the truth value. Okay. What else can I say about terminal objects? Well, there is one very interesting property of terminal objects, okay? It has to do with what is called generalized elements. So remember this picture? I said, instead of describing the elements that are inside your object, you can talk about arrows that are coming to this object, right? So in other words, talking about elements is equivalent to talking about arrows coming from other objects. Therefore, people call these arrows generalized elements. Okay? So arrows coming from other objects are called generalized elements. That's just a definition. But there is a special kind of generalized element, namely an arrow that comes from the terminal object. Okay? So arrows coming from terminal objects are called global elements. And this is the closest that you can get in category theory to talking about elements. Because in set theory, this is a singleton set. A morphism, a function from singleton set to any other set, just picks one element, right? So it is exactly picking an element. So these global elements in set theory, they are elements, equivalent to elements, okay? So if a category has a terminal object, this is the closest you can get to talking about elements. That's why they are called global elements. Generalized elements are a little bit more complex, right? So you might think, okay, I have here another object that has some kind of shape, okay? So when I have a morphism from another object to my object, it's picking a generalized element of particular shape. So this is, if this is A, this is like picking an element of shape A. Okay? So it's more general. This is just the language that you might see in category theory, people talking about. So these global elements will become very important to us. Why are they important? Because when we write these entailments, right, that something in some type A, right, sometimes we can say that A is of type A without any context. Like, what is without any context? What does it mean? Well, what we put here in this case, and we say an empty context. An empty context really consists of the unit type, okay? And if you do this, then A becomes a mapping from unit type to A, okay? So in our translation, an empty context would be actually a singleton, not an empty set. Okay? Okay. So these global elements are very important. And we'll see them. Okay. Now, we'll start constructing new categories. Because making a category is very easy, especially if you have some other category to start with, or a bunch of categories. So for every category, so take a category C, we can create a new category that's That's the opposite of it. It's called C op. How do we construct this category? So we have to say objects, morphisms, and composition, right? The objects in this category are the same objects as here. Okay? So we take the same objects. For morphisms, if there is a morphism here that goes from A to B, it becomes a morphism that goes from B to A. So you just reverse the arrows. Okay? All arrows in this category are in the opposite direction. They have the same names, right? But they go in the opposite direction. So how do we compose these guys? Well, so if you have F and G that goes from B to C, right? So G after F here goes from A to C, right? Now here, well, let's call it F op, just to, you know. G op will go from C to B, right? So we cannot do G op after F op because they don't match, right? But what we can do is F op after G op, right? That will get us, G op will go from C to B, F op will go from B to A, so this one will go from C to A, which is what G after F op should do, right? Okay? So we reverse all the arrows, and because we reverse all the arrows, we have to reverse the order of composition as well. But whatever composition table we had here, we can use it here just with this inversion, right? And it turns out that this creation of opposite categories is extremely useful because for every construction that you do, and we'll do several constructions, for every construction you can say, okay, let me try this construction in the opposite category, okay, and see what happens. And you always get something interesting, right? So, now let's go back to the definition of the terminal object, right? In the terminal object, we say from any object, A, there is a unique arrow to the terminal object. In the opposite category, we'll just reverse this thing and say, well, we'll write this upside down, right? There has to be a unique arrow from the, what should we call it, initial object, right? Initial object. So there is a unique arrow from an initial object to any other object in the category, right? If it exists. So now, should I prove that this is unique up to unique isomorphism? No, I don't have to. Because the proof that I gave you before for the terminal object will just work in the opposite category automatically, right? So all these proofs, that they just move nicely. So this is a nice way of using the opposite category because you just, I mean, I could go ahead and do this proof for an initial object, but why bother if I know that these proofs map to the opposite category, right? Okay. So, in Haskell, what would that mean in Haskell? It means that there is a unique morphism from this thing to an arbitrary type A. Okay? So what could this be? Cannot be unit, right? Unit has, like, if this A has many elements, it will have many morphisms, right? So the only thing that fits here is the void type. It's a little bit crazy, right? Void type corresponds to an empty set, sort of. because there is the non-termination problem in Haskell. So in Haskell, this is a little bit cheating, okay? But if you look in Haskell library, well, there is a function from void to A for any A, right? It's called absurd. What does this function do? Well, this function says, well, it doesn't do anything because it's not really even implemented. It doesn't need an implementation. Why doesn't it need an implementation? Because it says, if you provide me an element of void, then I'll give you an element of A. But good luck with providing an element of void, right? It's an empty set. There is no element of void. The only implementation for absurd, I mean, this is a polymorphic function, right? It's polymorphic in the return type. This is things that you can do in Haskell. Polymorphic in the return type. The only implementation that makes sense is when A itself is void, right? Then it's an identity on void. It says, if you give me an element of void, I'll give you back the same element. Okay, right? So it does exist, but it exists in vacuum. So in type theory, well, this is one of the things that are really not easy to write in type theory, because I told you that an empty context is a unit type, right? But in this case, you really have to have an empty context. Right? So you have to say something like this. Entailment. From an empty context, you can always derive an element of A. That's called absurd, right? So the translation of this, right, is what I said here. Absurd goes from void to A, right? One-to-one translation. So this is the only case in which you actually use a really empty context. So type theory, that's this. Haskell, category theory. What remains is logic, right? Logic. Okay, so if you give me a proof of So what is term initial object in logic? That's false, okay? False. The value of false, okay? So if you give me a proof of false, I can prove anything. That's why it's called absurd, okay? This is like, what's the Latin thing for this? Ex falso quod libet, right? Right. So from falsehood you can derive anything. So fits very nicely, okay? So we have, time flies. Okay. So let's just do a little bit of the next thing. So this is all about, yeah. So these were like sort of less interesting things, but a little bit tricky. And by the way, so for truth, what I gave you was an introduction. You can introduce truth from nothing, right? From false, it's an elimination. If you have false, then you can derive anything, right? So one of them has only introduction type. The other has only the elimination type. They don't have these pairs. So I don't have any beta or eta stuff because they don't have the other part. So the really first interesting type is a product type. Okay? And there are ways of introducing product type. I'll introduce a product type by constructing yet another category, because we are so used to constructing categories, right? So we'll start with some category C, and pick two objects in this category. It's like a magic trick. Pick two objects, right? Let's say A and B, okay? And I want to define the product of this A and B. So I'm going to create a new category from this, a category called the category of spans, okay? So how do I define a category? I have to define what objects are. So an object in this category of spans, let's call it span of AB. A and B are fixed, right? So a span of AB is a triple. Give me an object from category C and two morphisms. Let's call it F that goes from C to A, and another one, let's call it G, that goes from C to B. Okay? And of course, you need a picture for this, right? So this is this object C. A and B are fixed. C varies all over the category. So, you know, it has as many objects as the original category. Because it's C, and, well, it might have fewer objects because it might not have these morphisms. If it doesn't have a morphism from C to A, then you don't have an object. So this is F and this is G. Okay? So I have objects. What else do I need to define a category? Morphisms, right? Morphisms. Okay. So I'll take as a morphism. So let's say a morphism from a triple C F G to a triple C prime F prime G prime, right? So this is one object, this is another object. I want to have a morphism between them. So let me pick a morphism, let's call it H, that goes from C to C prime, right? And C prime is equipped with G prime and F prime. So this is another span, right? With C prime and two other functions, morphisms, right? And now I want to have a morphism between these two spans, so it will be a morphism from C to C prime, but I want these two triangles to commute. Because there are two ways of doing it. I mean, I can do F prime after F, and I can do G prime after G. They both have to be equal to H, okay? So the definition of the category of span includes these commuting triangles, okay? So it's a morphism that makes this triangle these two triangles commute. Okay, so this is my category. And now what's a product of A and B? The product of A and B is the terminal object in the category of span. Okay, so now I have to translate this. Okay, so this is where actually usually people start the definition. But I wanted to do this as a terminal object in some other category because now I won't have to prove again that it's unique up to unique isomorphism. Because if it's a terminal object in some category, then it's unique up to unique isomorphism. Right? So this is out of the way now. Don't have to worry about this. So a terminal object will be a span. So let me draw this span. So I called this A cross B. This is my object that is terminal in the category of spans over A and B. Okay? And I'm going to name these two morphisms. I'm going to name this first and then this one second. Okay? So you might be already recognizing. But I'm just naming them like this. So this is a span, and it's terminal in this category of spans, meaning that for any other span, let's call it C with F and G, right? So this is a span, arbitrary span. for any span, there is a unique morphism from this span to this span, right? Because this is terminal. So I'm going to draw a dotted line. Call it, well, I will call it F, G in brackets like this. Okay? That's just the name for this guy. So for every C that has F and G, I have this. Okay? So this is what usually people give you as a definition of a product. It's a definition in terms of universal construction. So it's a universal construction of a product, right? So let's analyze it a little bit. So first of all, let's translate. Okay. So we have F is a morphism. So now if I want to translate it into type theory, let me rename this to gamma. Okay? I can name it whatever I want, right? But we want to have this as a context, right? So the description of this picture, so there are two ways of describing it. One is F is a morphism that goes from gamma to A, right? That's how you write this arrow in category theory. It's a morphism F from gamma to A, okay? G. Morphism that goes from gamma to B. Okay? So if I have a morphism F and G, then there exists a morphism that I called F, G, right? That goes from gamma, okay, to A cross B. Okay? So I just do trivial translation, right? And I see something like this. Okay? This is this picture. I mean, this picture is much easier to remember than this. But this is an introduction rule. This is an introduction rule for product. Tells me how I can construct a product. I need an element of A, and I need an element of B, and I have an element of A. Right? So this is the introduction rule. What's the elimination rule? Well, the elimination rule says that if I have, in some context, if I have a pair of type A cross B, right? So now I'm saying if I have a pair like this, right, then in the same, then what do I have? And I have F and G, right? So I have the same thing, F, A, gamma, G, B, right? Let me just write it. First of P will be a type, what's the type? A, right? So in gamma, I have first of P. So this okay, I don't need this, right? I just need this. So this is an elimination rule, which says if you give me an element of A cross B, right, then I have a projection of this that's of type A, right? So if this is intra, this is eliminate. It eliminates a pair, right? I'm calling it a pair already, right? But it's an element of a product is called a pair. Okay, now the beta rule for this, because now we have elimination and introduction, right? So if I eliminate what I introduced, so the elimination, the beta rule will be first, which is the elimination, right, of AB, which is an intra. So I introduce a pair of type A and B, and then I use first to eliminate it. Then I should get, what should I get? A, right? Well, I could call this F and G. Yes.
Yeah, because I was thinking like why do you place gamma there if we are starting from A cross B, but I was not know it's because we are using the composition.
We are using the composition first after P, right? From gamma P then first. Yeah. Right, right. This kind of looks like an application of a function to an element, right? Yeah. Okay. So of course there are two beta rules. There is also the second of FG is equal G, right? And these two beta rules just tell you that these triangles commute. That's why it's so much easier to do it in category theory, right? It just says that first after FG is the same as F, right? Now, the eta rule is interesting, because for the eta rule, the eta rule says, actually, is derived from the uniqueness, okay? So when I said that there is that's the existence, right? But I said it's unique. So if you have any other way of doing this, then it must be equal to F and G, okay? So here's an equality. Right? So what would the any other be? So P would be a morphism from gamma to A cross B. Okay, that's the translation of this thing. Right? And then there is F that is a morphism that goes from gamma to A, right? And there is G that goes from gamma to B, right? So P, okay. And it says that in gamma, P is equal That's the eta rule. Right? I have two ways of doing this. I can say, okay, F and G goes from, I can do the direct product of these two, F and G, and that's my right? Factorization of this span. And if I have any other morphism, then they have to be equal. Yes. Okay, okay. Let's try this. First of P, second of P. Then I don't need FNG, right? You're right. Does this work? Okay. Huh? I didn't put which one. This one? Oh, oh. Yes, obviously. Yes, yes, yes. Okay, you're right. You're right. Right. There are two elimination rules. Yes. Okay. And finally, in terms of logic. This intro rule means if F is a proof of A and G is a proof of B, then a pair FG is a proof of A and B. Okay? So the translation of the okay. But that's exactly the same thing as a product. Okay? And all these rules, I mean, the elimination rule trivially says that if A and B is true, then A is true, right? And the proof of this is first. If A and B is true, then B is true. And the proof of this is the second of B, right? So it's all proof-relevant logic, very nicely proof-relevant. I think this is a good point to stop. We'll continue next time.